Galileo wanted to perform experiments. Unlike those who came before him, he didn't want to just sit around and talk about how objects moved. He wanted to test how objects moved, and he built a ramp to do so. And we wanted to explore motion with you, so we built an even bigger one. Galileo made a ramp and rolled the metal ball down it at known intervals. He timed the descents of the ball using a water clock. He had a water clock with an upper vessel that streamed water into a lower vessel at a constant rate. Galileo measured the weight of the water on a scale. He would look at the ratio between the weight of the water and how far the ball traveled. He repeated his experiment many times and at various angles. One version of his ramp had bells at set distances. The sound of the bell would signify the position of the ball on the ramp. We created our own version using PVC pipe, vintage bike bells, clamps, bell holders, and a ball bearing. Instead of using a water clock, we used the sound sensor on the Science Journal app. When the ball was rung, there was a spike on the graph. Like Galileo, we ran this experiment several times and at different angles. What do you think the time difference was between each of the intervals? And what impact do you think the change in angle had on the recorded times? On the bottom of the graph, we marked out our x-axis. This is the time, which is our independent variable. On the y-axis, we marked out our dependent variable, which is the distance location for each of the bells. Each of the data points represents a different bell ringing. The ball was in the upper segment of the ramp for longer periods of time than it was the lower ones. And the higher the angle of the ramp, the less time it spent in each of the intervals. This comparison of change in position over time is known as velocity. When you were thinking about how the ball's motion was changing down the ramp, you might have described it as speeding up. And speed is very closely related to velocity. Speed and velocity both tell you how quickly something is moving. But speed is a scalar, and velocity is a vector. If you say that you're moving 60 miles per hour in a car, you're describing its speed. If you're saying you're moving 60 miles per hour to the northeast, then you're talking about its velocity, because it now has a magnitude and a direction. And knowing the direction of velocity might seem useless when you're just driving on the road. You're usually only concerned about the speed limit, which is a magnitude, but the orientation matters when you hit a patch of ice and now your car is moving in multiple directions. The direction velocity is pointing also matters when you're testing out its safety features. If direction matters when dealing with velocity, then why didn't we take the angle of the ramp into account on our graphs? Well, as we stated in our position video, picking the proper location of your coordinate system can really simplify a problem. And since our ball is only moving in one direction, we angled our coordinate system to align with the angle of the ramp. To find the actual values for velocity, we wanted the ball to be on a bigger ramp with lots of sensors. We constructed a 60-foot ramp. We used 31 sets of brake beams, and these were the same sensors that we used in our encoder videos. They were placed every 2 feet along the ramp. When the ball passed through a set of sensors, it read broken. We wired all the sensors back to a power supply and an Arduino Mega. The Mega used its onboard quartz clock to keep track of time, and it monitored the broken and unbroken states of every pair of sensors. Just like with a smaller ramp, the ball sped up as it went down. The last two sections were kind of different because the material was different. This slowed the ball down. This is why the curve dips slightly after 40 feet. We find the velocity of the ball through each section by subtracting the starting position in time from the end position in time. This is not the velocity of the ball at any given moment. This is the average velocity of the ball moving through each given section. The difference in position in the numerator is called the displacement of the ball. If your fitness tracker says that you've biked 20 miles, this is the distance that you've traveled. The displacement is a vector. It is only concerned with where you started and where you stopped. And since you started and ended at your house, your displacement is zero. If you bike on a trail to a campground, the distance takes into account all the twists and turns along the way. Displacement is just a line from the start of the trail to the end of the trail. So you might have biked 35 miles around the winding trail, but your displacement might only be 15 miles southwest. Since it's a vector, it also needs direction. Graphically, we find the velocity of the ball by drawing a line between each of the data points. The average velocity is drawn on a graph using a secant line. The instantaneous velocity is drawn on the graph using a tangent line. The slope of the secant is the average velocity the ball has traveled through any section. The slope of the tangent at any point is the instantaneous velocity. Since we need 2 points to define the slope of the line, we cannot use basic algebra to define the velocity at any point. This is why the issue of finding instantaneous velocity was called the tangent problem. It took Newton and Leibniz discovering calculus to solve it. And we're going to discuss this more in our next video when we talk about derivatives and instantaneous velocity. The only time that your average velocity and your instantaneous velocity are equal is when you have a constant velocity, because this is represented by a straight line. We've used a lot of notation for velocity in this video, so let's sort out the four main types that we've seen. Velocity can be shown as a full vector quantity. These notations have arrows, angles, are bold, or show all the components of the vector. Velocity is sometimes only shown as a component. Often you'll see these written as v sub x, v sub y, or v sub z. These are all showing you velocity in one particular direction. In this video, we use v sub x. Average velocity is usually denoted with a bar over top or with an AV or an AVG subscript. Instantaneous velocity can be shown as initial velocity, as a final velocity, or as a velocity at any given point. The notation will tell you what type of velocity you're working with. Thank you to Google's Making in Science team. Without them, we would have never built this 60-foot ramp. If you want to find more great science content, you can go to their playlist, or you can use the hashtag ScienceGoals. If you want us to make more elaborate contraptions like this one in the future, you can support us at patreon.com/scijoy, and we look forward to talking to you in the comments below and on social media. And remember, keep exploring.